Praise the Lord, everybody. I love what the psalmist says in Psalms 91. It says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." And it says, "I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress." Everybody say, "My God." "My God, in Him will I trust. Surely He shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For He shall give His angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou shalt dash thy foot against the stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and upon the adder. The young lion and the dragon shall thou trample underfoot, because He has set His love upon you. He has set His love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him, and I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him, and with long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation." You know what I feel like doing? I will say of the Lord, "He is my refuge and my strength." It doesn't matter what you go through. Does anybody have a praise in your spirit tonight? Can we lift our hands all over this building and love Him? Father, we love You. We open up this service tonight in praise and adoration to You. God, without You, we're absolutely nothing. God, I pray You bless this service tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Why don't we clap our hands to the Lord and love Him?
The whole earth sings Your praise. The whole earth. Up in the presence of the Lord. God, we come to worship you in this house.
To age. the Godhead three in one. Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb, the Lion and the Lamb.
With our hands lifted, come on, say, how great.
How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God.
Thank you, Jesus. I wonder if we could put that slide up again real quick where it says, name above all names. Jesus' name. I felt this in my spirit while we were singing it. It says, name above all names. Let that be something different for you tonight. I'm going to say that names is Christian. Say your name. Name above you. Name above your thoughts. Name above your fears. Name above all anxiety. Name above all depression. Name above all thoughts that are not godly. Name above it all, because Jesus is above every single situation that you brought into this place tonight. It doesn't matter if it's been plaguing you for weeks, for months, for years. One moment with the King, one moment in this altar, one moment with my God can change it all. Amen. I wonder if some of you that came up into this place are a little fed up with what you've been dealing with. Well, I believe that tonight it can end in the name of Jesus. There is freedom in this house. There is freedom at the mention of the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. What an honor it is to be in this place with each and every one of you tonight. And I believe that we've already felt a great presence of God. Amen. And it's only going to get better. As you make your way back to your seats, I would like to welcome you to Cross Church on a rainy Thursday night. It might be bad outside, but it's good in here, and the presence of God is moving in here. Amen. As usual, we will continue to have our announcements on the screen before service, during offering, and after service. So please pay attention to our screens so that you can see all of the dates and times of what is going on here at the Cross Church. Something very exciting is taking place next week. Can everybody say family camp? Once again, family camp. This will be June 28th through the 30th. I believe that that is next Thursday and goes through to Saturday. This is a great opportunity for everybody of all ages to join us at the Solid Rock Church in Oak Hill. There will be multiple services, morning services and night services, and this will be a great time to gather in fellowship with those of the West Virginia and Western Maryland District, and we are going to have a great time. If you do not already follow the West Virginia and Western Maryland District page on Facebook or whatever social media platform you're on, I encourage you to do that, because there are a lot of important details. And that slide specifically that has all of the dates and times of the services, and you do not want to miss that. Amen. The youth is going to be having a bake sale this Sunday. Amen. Woo! We're just trying to raise some more funds for trips and things we want to do with the youth this summer and later into this year. So we are going to be having a bake sale this Sunday, along with a silent auction with the bake sale. So please, parents of the youth, please make something for this bake sale, and we cannot wait to share some goodies with the church on Sunday. Amen. If everyone could please stand as we move forward to our offering. What an incredible time it is to give and give back to the kingdom. There are three ways that you can give here at the Cross Church. You can give online to thecrosschurch.net. You can mail your offering to 1122 Market Street, Parkersburg, West Virginia, 26101. Or you can text the word GIVE to 1-877-681-7188. Church, let's pray. God, we thank you for your presence that's already in this place tonight. We thank you, Jesus, for what you've done for us. And we also thank you for what we know you're going to continue to do, God. You are great. You are greatly to be praised. And you are above every single situation that we brought into this house, God. And we ask you right now to touch this offering, this tithe, Lord Jesus. Let it go for your kingdom and let it go for your glory as you call us in your word to do so, Jesus. We praise you and we honor you in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, kids and youth, you are dismissed.
Of God this evening. I know it's pouring the rain outside, but we need it, right? I do want to say to all of our guests, we're glad you're here tonight. I pray you feel at home. It's so good to have Sister Kim and Sister Tony back with us, and I think are they downstairs working? There's Sister Tony. I see you right there. So good to have you back in town. I do want to take a moment here and pray for Mama Kay, that God would touch her body. She's in the hospital and been battling with her kidneys. And I believe that God could touch her. And I know we've been up and down standing. Could we stand one more time before the ministry comes to preach? I want to pray for Sister Mindy as well. She had a procedure done, and she's not healing, and I'm telling on her because we need to pray. And she's on vacation with her family, but I want God to heal Sister Mindy and Mama Kay. I believe God could give Mama Kay such a healing today that she could come home tomorrow. I really believe that, and her kidney function's real low. But why don't we lift our hands and pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask you to touch Mama Kay right now, Lord, that you touch her body. God, I pray let her kidneys begin to work perfect in the name of Jesus Christ. Do it today, right now. And I pray for Sister Mindy, God, our minister of music right now. I pray, God, that you would heal her. I pray, God, that you would let her body begin to heal perfectly right now in the name of Jesus. I pray, God, you would impart strength to them. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Give somebody a high five and say, I believe it. Praise the Lord. Make sure this weekend and come. How many is going to bring somebody with you on Sunday morning? Say amen. We'll have a great time in the Holy Ghost. And I have felt to have, and I called him, and I felt for Brother Mark to preach tonight. I am so proud of the ministry in this church. And he's not a novice. He's been preaching for a while. But I'm so glad for a church that has a place for ministers to grow. All I've ever been a part of is growing churches. My daddy always had a pulpit for people that were in ministry that was learning. And I remember when the first time I got up to preach, I was shaking about like this, you know. Y'all still here? And I remember I had that old coal miner voice, talk like this right here, you know. I talked on the CB radio all the time, and my dad and that precious church put up with me. Sister Kim, they put up with me. But I look at the ministry that is in this church, all the speakers and all the ones that minister. And I want to tell you, Brother Mark is no novice. He helps at Ripley. He does a lot of ministry. He is now our Section 3 Children's Ministry representative. Very much respected in this city and around our state. And I know, you know, when a preacher steps up to a pulpit, most of the time they have sometimes a week in a message. I preached a message one time, and I probably had a year in that message carrying that. And so I know he has a word for our church tonight. And I wonder if we could lift our hands as the man of God comes and just say, God, speak to my heart tonight. Could we do that as Brother Mark comes?
Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, I worship you, God. Lord, I thank you for what you're doing, God. God, I thank you for your touch, Lord. I thank you for your favor, God, your anointing, God. Lord, I ask that you move in here tonight, God. Lord, I pray that you prepare our spirit for what you have, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to be reading now the book of John, chapter 5, verses 1 through 9. Appreciate my pastor and trusting me and allowing me to come up here and grow. And I appreciate everybody in here and my beautiful wife and my amazing daughter, Lakin. I don't know where she's at. She's downstairs. And my favorite nephew, Nicholas. So glad you're here. He's a little bit embarrassed. He's seen his Uncle Mark at the worst, but he's getting ready to see him at the best. He hasn't seen this side of his Uncle Mark. He's only seen the rough, out of control, you know, breaking the law, not caring what's going on. But now he's getting to see a true man of God. And I'm excited for you, Nick, and I love you dearly. And I pray that I'm a light in your eyes. John chapter 5, verse 1. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, there is at Jerusalem by the sheep market a pool, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Bethesda, having five porches. In these laid a great multitude of impotent folk, a blind, halt, withered, waiting for the moving of the water. And for an angel went down at a certain season in the pool and troubled the water. Whosoever then first, after the troubling of the water, stepped in, was made whole of whatsoever disease they had. And a certain man was there which had an infirmity of 38 years, When Jesus saw him lie and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, Wilt thou be made whole? The impotent man answered him, Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me into the pool, but while I am coming, another step down before me. Jesus said unto him, Rise, take up thy bed and walk. And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. Church, I'd like to preach to you for a few minutes tonight. There is power in a made up mind. Let's pray. Lord, I love you, God. Jesus, I thank you for what you're doing. Father, I ask that you bless the word. Anoint me to preach, God, and anoint the congregation to receive the message. In Jesus' name, God bless you. You may be seated. The pool of Bethesda was where the miracles happened. It was kind of like the church nowadays. If you needed a healing or a touch from God, you would go to it and wait for an angel to come. I've had this in my spirit for a while now. I've spent a lot of time with the Lord today. He's been heavy on my heart this week. The Bible says there was all kinds of walks of life waiting for the angel to come and trouble the water. A great multitude of impotent folk, a blind, halt, withered, waiting for the water to start moving. And the first one to get in would receive their miracle, would be healed of whatever disease they had. I believe if I was waiting on a miracle, I would have just jumped right down in the pool and waited. You're not beating me if I'm already in there. Hey. Waiting for the water to be rippled. Let me take a break and tell someone, if you need your miracle, if you need a touch from God, you don't have to wait for a certain season. You can get it right now. You can receive your miracle right now. Healing can take place. Deliverance can happen right now. Depression has to leave. Sickness has to leave. Chains of addiction have to break. In Jesus' name, I'm so thankful I don't have to lay by a pool and wait for a certain season. I know I can go to Jesus at any time, any situation. Thank you, Lord. When I study, I like to put myself right in the story. I like to physically put myself in the story. I like to emotionally put myself in the story. I can feel the cold dirt. Maybe it's rocks by the pool. Maybe I'm laying on rock. I can smell the water. I can feel the cool breeze of the wind. I can feel the dirt on my arms from laying by the pool. I'm looking around at all the sick and helpless people. I'm not just seeing the disease. I'm not just seeing the paralyzed. I'm looking into their life. I'm seeing the brokenness. I'm seeing the hurting. I'm seeing the helplessness. I'm seeing people that have never had the choice to enjoy life. I'm seeing people bound by fear. I'm seeing loneliness people. I'm seeing ones that's been betrayed. I'm seeing ones that have been counted out. I'm seeing the broken people. Are you down in the pool with me right now? Can you see it? I can feel the loneliness. I can feel the hopelessness. I can feel the anxiety. I can feel the constant frustration. I can feel the anger. I'm sure he felt like he didn't have no purpose. I'm sure he felt like he didn't have no direction in his life. I'm sure he felt he was useless. This is a man laying by the pool being tormented. I'm sure he missed a lot of things in his life. I'm sure he didn't have closure to a lot of things. I can only imagine what he's thinking about. Where is my friends? Where is my family? Where is my community? Where is my neighbor? He laid by this pool for 38 years. Watching others receive their miracles, that would be very discouraging. He watched the miracles happen right before his eyes. He watched the healings happen right before his eyes. He didn't give up. He didn't quit. His mind was made up. He watched others step into water before him. I think we can all take something from this story. Don't give up. Keep pressing. You will reach the troubled waters. You might have to wade through some stuff. You will receive your miracles. Don't give up. Hold on even when the times are hard. Even when you can't see the water. Can you only imagine laying by the pool, waiting year after year, the chance to receive your miracle? I want to speak to the church tonight. Your miracle is coming. You're about to receive your healing. Jesus is working in this place right now. Jesus is fixing situations. Jesus is reaching lost loved ones. We have to have a mind made up. Jesus is in control. Can you imagine laying by the pool, watching others receive their miracles right before your eyes, year after year? I'll go even farther. How about watching the seats fill up beside you? How about watching families being put back together? Year after year, I love it. I'm grateful for it. How about the ones that are still waiting on their family to come? You're watching everybody else's family come, but you're still waiting on yours. You hear this preacher tonight. Don't give up. Your family will be beside you. You will see your family put back together. Your family is coming to the Lord. I believe this wholeheartedly. If you quit, they never stand a chance. Listen to me. If you quit, they don't stand a chance. I was the black sheep of my family. I was the cousin that went too far. I was the family member that was the last to be invited to the barbecue. There's hope, I promise you. Just how God changed my life, He can change your family's life. We're here breaking generational curses. Come on, somebody. We have to take a stand and say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Hallelujah. Devil, you can't have my family. Devil, you get your hands off of my kids. Whew. Devil, you can't have my brother and sister. Hallelujah, Jesus. Why is it we can get an idea in our head and not stop until it's done? Like, for instance, if you decide to get a new car, if you decide to get a new truck, if you decide to go on vacation, we get these ideas in our head and we will compulse over them. We'll make a way. It don't matter what we have to do, how much work it takes. It doesn't matter how far in debt we have to go. Why can't we be like this to the things that pertaineth to God? Let's get the same determination. My family's going to make it to heaven. My friends are going to make it to heaven. I'm saving seats in a row for my family. I'll go however far I have to reach them. I'll do whatever it takes. I'm not holding back. I'm not stopping till it's done. I pray that everyone sees Jesus through me. I pray they can see the goodness of God through me. I pray they see Jesus' love and compassionate through me. I've made up my mind. I will not waver from this life. I'm dedicated to the gospel. I'm dedicated to serving God. I will not waver from His word. I will stand strong in the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. After 38 years laying by the pool, here come Jesus. After suffering for a long time, this man was about to receive his miracle. He didn't even know it. The Bible says when Jesus saw him and knew that he had been now a long time in that case, he said unto him, "Will thou be made whole?" Listen to what the man said. "Sir, I have no man when the water is troubled to put me in the pool. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." You know what he's saying? I have no church. I have no brothers or sisters to help me. There are many people that don't have any church to help them. We have to be that church, and we are. There are many addicts out there that don't have anyone to witness to them. There's a whole community of addicts that are lost. There's a whole community of the people that have been counted out. There's a whole community of the world that says they are a lost cause. Let me tell this church tonight, I was that person counted out. I was the addict that was considered too far to be gone. But look what the Lord can do. I'm a testimony of what the goodness of God can do. This is not my power. This is the Lord you serve. There's people in this room right now. God is calling you to a higher place. There's going to be more recovering drug addicts that turn apostolic preachers. God is changing lives. I'm watching it with my own eyes. God is working. Deliverance is taking place. You're going to watch your family put back together. Marriage is back together. Kids are going to have their parents back. Lives are going to be changed, all because the church is willing to reach the lost. I was a lot like this man laying by the pool. I didn't have anyone to help me into the water. I didn't have the church. I was destined for a life of misery. Then one day Jesus came and I didn't even realize it. He walked right up to me and put someone in my path to give me a hand to help me when I needed it. Jesus put a brother to help me in the water. I couldn't do it on my own. I needed help. I couldn't walk to the water. I could see the water, but I couldn't get to him. It was impossible for me without having help. I believe that if God can change me, he can change anyone. Nobody is too far gone. There is hope. Jesus put a loving church like this one in my life, a welcoming church, a church that didn't judge me. I'm convinced that if this church wasn't here, I would be dead. And that's the truth. I know it wholeheartedly. I know it wholeheartedly. Just like the man by the pool, I laid for years without help. But in one moment with Jesus, I was completely delivered. I was completely healed. The chains of addiction was broke. Jesus completely restored my life. It's hard to believe how much God has changed my life. It was never me. I didn't have the power to change it. Jesus stepped in a life of chaos and instantly changed me. John 5:8. Jesus said unto him, "Rise, take up thy bed and walk." And immediately the man was made whole and took up his bed and walked. And on the same day was the Sabbath. 38 years of waiting. In one moment with Jesus, he was immediately healed. In one moment. He was not only walking, he was carrying the bed. I can feel somebody has been waiting for years for their miracle. I feel it in my spirit. Somebody has been praying for a miracle for a long time. God's getting ready to answer that prayer. There's been some parents out there been praying for God to reach their kids. There's been some prayers for some family members. God is getting ready to touch them. God's getting ready to move. Lives are getting ready to be changed. Someone has been laying by the pool for too long waiting for Jesus. Somebody is getting their miracle tonight. God had dealt every man a measure of faith. Every man a measure of faith. Matthew 17:20. And Jesus said unto them, "Because of your unbelief, for verily I say unto you, if you have faith as a grain of mustard seed, you shall say unto the mountain, remove hence to yonder place, and it shall remove. Nothing shall be impossible for you." Faith as a grain of mustard seed. Anyone ever seen a mustard seed? They're very small. You only need a little bit of faith. And you can move mountains. It only takes a little bit of faith for that situation. And nothing shall be impossible for you. No situation is impossible. Let's start speaking life into the dead situations. It's time to start believing. It's time to start moving mountains. It's time to break down strongholds in our life. Maybe you don't need the miracle yourself. Well, let's believe for somebody else. Hebrews 11 and 1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. I thank God for the elders of the church. If it's not for you carrying the gospel, I would have never met Jesus. The new converts need to hear your testimonies. Need to hear about the healing. Need to hear about the deliverance. Need to hear about the families being put back together. I feel over 38 years this man was laying by the pool. He had a lot of resentment towards others. It would be hard to lay there and not build resentment. I'm sure he was struggling to forgive. What's the point? Why do I need to forgive? It would be hard to be in that situation and not have hate in your heart. Why is it so hard to forgive someone? When we don't forgive, it holds us captive. This can drive us crazy. It can cause us to act like a fool. I know y'all were perfect and never had no resentment. Maybe I'm preaching to myself right now. But Jesus was beaten, abused. They beat him with a cat of nine tails. They ripped handfuls of his beard out. They spit on him. They smashed a crown of thorns on his head. Jesus was bloody, hurt, damaged, beaten, unrecognizable. He was crucified. Spikes pounded through his hands and his feet. Luke 23 and 34, then Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiments and cast lots. Jesus looked down from the cross upon the scene, and he must have been distressed. The Roman soldiers were gambling for his clothes. The criminals on the cross to either side of him were revealing him. The religious leaders were mocking him. The crowd was blaspheming him. Surrounded by the worst, Jesus prayed for them. Father, forgive them. Is a prayer of unmatched mercy and love. Forgiveness is hard. The Bible tells us to forgive, Matthew 16 and 14. For if you forgive men of their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if ye forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you. We have to remember, forgiveness is not for them, it is for us. I don't want hate or bitterness in my heart. I want to have a clear conscience towards God. If Jesus can get tortured like this and pray for forgiveness for others, I believe I can let things go. I believe I can let things go and not hold on to it. I believe God is tugging on someone's hearts tonight. I believe God is revealing some things to you guys tonight. Hallelujah. I believe God is asking us to search our hearts. I'm almost done. We can all stand. I'm not a long-winded preacher. I'm working on it. Yes. I don't know how long this man was laying by the pool. All I know, he had been there 38 years. I wonder how old he was when he got to the pool. I wonder, was maybe he just a kid? Maybe he was a teen. Broken, scared, hurt, having no one to help him. How long did his family wait with him? Did they even make an attempt? Jesus. Did they even wait at all? It started all at a prayer meeting this Monday with a couple elders in my life. The Lord's been dealing with me. The Lord's been making me a better man. Maybe this is for me and not you. Jesus. God was dealing with is for forgiveness. I started searching deep, looking in every crack and crevice in my heart. I don't want no hate. I don't want anything in my heart that's going to pull me from God. And I asked God to reveal some things to me. It wasn't immediate. It was a day later. I was still on it. I was still searching. Because I don't want something holding me up for God to use me somewhere in any situation. I want to be like Christ. I can't have nothing. I can't have nothing to hold me back. I can't have nothing. I was mowing, meditating, talking to God. And He crushed me. He revealed a scar so deep in my spirit I didn't even know I had it. It was very painful. It was single-handedly the hardest thing for me to ever forgive. I thank Jesus for that. It made me a better person. It made me a better person. That scar was so deep. I didn't even know it was a scar. I didn't even know I was holding on to it. I think that there's some people in here tonight that's buried stuff down inside of them too deep. That you've put it away. You don't even know that it affects you. Thank you, Lord. Let's all come to the altar tonight. Maybe you're not the man by the pool. Maybe you have been holding on to something. Maybe somebody done something to you years ago and you've hid it. Jesus is getting ready to release you from that bondage. Maybe it's your family member by the pool. How long are you willing to stand by them? How long are you willing to sit by the pool and wait for God to work in their life? I believe you will see your family saved. I believe that Jesus is going to reach every family member in here. Church, let's pray. Lord, I love you, God. Oh, Jesus, I pray that you speak to every person, God. Lord, I pray that you reveal things to them, God. Darkest parts of their heart, God, help them, Father, in Jesus' name.
Falling in love with Jesus.
Was the best thing I'd ever done.
There's no place I'd rather be. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I'd ever done.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I'd ever done. Love the Lord right now. Thank Him for that word tonight. With Jesus, oh, falling in love with Jesus. Somebody sing it. Falling in love with Jesus. I feel the Holy Ghost.
Was the best thing I'd ever done.
Falling in love with Jesus.
best thing I've ever done.
When we clap our hands to the Lord and love Him all over this building. God, we love You, Jesus. Thank You, Lord. Brother Mark, thank You for that word. Where are you at? Thank You for that word tonight. Such an honor to have your nephew here. And I'm so proud of you. And he's got, Brother Mark's got one of the most powerful testimonies. It's such a timely word. And I'm so proud of you. Gonna be more proud if you was my own boy. And but if you could, you know, and I know he's got a whole testimony and he tells a testimony, but just realizing where he was in prison and walking to church for a year. Was it a year? 6 months felt like a year. I can just see you walking from that halfway house or whatever to church in bad weather in a suit. We got him a suit. All the way down Lynn Street. That's a rough street to be walking down with a suit anyway. Right? And coming to church, and I remember people with all their excuses why they couldn't come, and Mark was walking in. Look what God's done with their family. Morgan, you guys are blessed, and I'm so proud of you. Praise God. Praise the Lord. To all of our guests, I pray you feel at home. How many's ready for church Sunday? Somebody said it's party time. I heard somebody say it today. They call it party time. So we're going to have a great time Sunday morning in Jesus' name. Please remember family camp next week if you can go. God is good to us. Praise God. I know we got announcements on the screen, so I'm not going to repeat them. Give somebody a high five and say, I'll see you on Sunday. Save me a seat. Amen. God bless you in Jesus' name.